in which Cimmerian discovers the value of classical education and has some unwelcome visitors. Chapter 2. Inside the hovel was dark and cool and damp. Cimmerian found it a pleasant relief after the hot, dusty road, but she wondered why no sunlight seemed to be coming through the cracks in the boards. She was still standing just inside the door, waiting for her eyes to adjust to the dark when someone said crossly, "Is this that princess we've been waiting for?" "Why don't you ask her?" said a deep, rumbly voice. "I'm Princess Cimmerian of Lenderwall," Cimmerian answered politely. "I was told you could help me."
"Help her?" said the first voice, and Cimmerian heard a snort. "I think we should just eat her and be done with it."
Cimmerian began to feel frightened. She wondered whether the voices belonged to ogres or trolls, or whether she could slip out of the hovel before they made up their minds about eating her. She felt behind her for the door and started in surprise when her fingers touched damp stone instead of dry wood. Then a third voice said, "Not so fast, Warrug. Let's hear her story first." So Cimmerian took a deep breath and began to explain about the fencing lessons and the magic lessons and the Latin and the juggling and all the other things that weren't considered proper behavior for a princess. And she told the voices that she had run away from Sathen by the Mountains to keep from having to marry Prince Therindel.
"And what do you expect us to do about it?" one of the voices asked curiously.
"I don't know," said Cimmerian said, "except, of course, that I would rather not be eaten. I can't see who you are in this dark, you know."
"That can be fixed," said the voice. A moment later, a small ball of light appeared in the air above Cimmerian's head. Cimmerian stepped backward very quickly and ran into the wall.
The voices belonged to dragons. Five of them lay on or sprawled over and curled around various rocks and columns that filled the huge cave where Cimmerian stood. Each of the males, there were three, had two short, stubby, sharp-looking horns on either side of their heads. The female dragon had three, and one on each side and one in the center of her forehead. The last dragon was apparently still too young to have made up its mind which sex it wanted to be. It didn't have any horns at all. Cimmerian felt very frightened. The smallest of the dragons was easily three times as tall as she was, and they gave an overwhelming impression of shining green scales and sharp silver teeth. They were much scarier in person than in the pictures she remembered from her natural history books. She swallowed very hard, wondering whether she really would rather be eaten by a dragon than marry Therindel.
"Well," said the three-horned dragon just in front of her, "just what are you asking us to do for you?"
"I..." Cimmerian stopped short as an idea occurred to her. Cautiously, she asked, "Dragons are fond of princesses, aren't they?"
"Very," said the dragon, and smiled. The smile showed all her teeth, which Cimmerian did not find reassuring.
"That is, I've heard of dragons who have captive princesses and cook for them, and so on," said Cimmerian, who had very little idea what captive princesses did all day. The dragon in front of Cimmerian nodded, and one of the others, a yellowish-green in color, shifted restlessly and said, "Oh, let's just go ahead and eat her. It'll save trouble." Before any of the other dragons could answer, there was a loud, booming voice, and a sixth dragon slithered into the cave. His scales were more gray than green, and the dragons by the door made way for him respectfully.
"Kazoo!" said the newcomer in a loud voice.
"Achoo! Sorry I'm late, but a terrible thing happened on the way here. Achoo!"
"What was that?"
"What is it?" said the dragon to whom Cimmerian had been talking. "Ran into a wizard. Had to eat him. No help for it. And now look at me." Every time the gray-green dragon sneezed, he emitted a small ball of fire that scorched the wall of the cave.
"Calm down, Roxham. You're only making it worse."
"Achoo! Calm down? When I'm having an allergy attack? Oh, bother. Achoo! Somebody give me a handkerchief. Achoo!"
"Here," said Cimmerian, holding out one of the ones she had brought with her. "Use this." She was beginning to feel much less frightened, for the gray-green dragon reminded her of her great-uncle, who was old and rather hard of hearing, and of whom she was rather fond.
"What's that?" said Roxham.
"Achoo!"
"Oh, hurry up and give it here."
Kazel took the handkerchief from Cimmerian, using two claws very delicately, and passed it to Roxham. The gray-green dragon mopped his streaming eyes and blew his nose.
"That's better, I think. Achoo!
Oh, drat!"
The ball of fire that accompanied the dragon's knees had reduced the handkerchief to a charred scrap. Cimmerian hastily dug out another one and handed it to Kazul, feeling very glad that she had brought several spares.
Roxham went through two more handkerchiefs before his sneezing spasms finally stopped. "Much better," he said. "Now then, who's this that let me the handkerchiefs? Somebody news princess, eh?" "We were just discussing that when you came in," Kazul said, and turned back to Simran. "You were saying about cooking and so on?" "Couldn't I do that one for you for a while?" Simran said. The dragon smiled again, and she swallowed hard. "Possibly. Why would you want to do that?" "Because then I wouldn't have to go home and marry Therindale," Simran said. "Being a dragon's princess is a perfectly respectful thing to do, so my parents couldn't complain, and it would be much more interesting than embroidery and dancing lessons." Several dragons made snorting and choking noises. Simran jumped, then decided that they were laughing. "This is ridiculous," said a large, bright green dragon on Simran's left. "Why?" asked Kazul. "A princess volunteering? Out of the question." "That's easy for you to say," one of the other dragons grumbled. "You already have a princess. What about the rest of us?" "Yes, don't be stuffy, Warug," said another. "Besides, what else can we do with her?" "Eat her," suggested the yellowish-green dragon in a bored tone. "No proper princess would come out looking for the dragons," Warug objected. "Well, I'm not a proper princess then," Simran snapped. "I make Cherry's Jubilee, and I volunteer for dragons, conjugate Latin verbs, or at least I would if anyone would let me, so there." "Hear, hear," said the gray-green dragon. "You see," Warwick said, "who would want an improper princess?"
"I would," said Kazil.
"You can't be serious, Kazil," Warwick said irritably. "Why?"
"I like Cherry's Jubilee," Kazil replied, still watching Simran. "And I like the look of her. Besides, the Latin scrolls in my library need cataloging, and if I can't find someone who knows a little of the language, I'll have to do it myself."
"Give her a trial run first," the purplish-green dragon advised. Warug snorted. "Latin and Cherry's Jubilee, and for that you take on a black-haired, snippy little..." "Ah, thank you to be polite when you're discussing my princess," Kazil said, and smiled fiercely. "Nice little gal," Roxham said, nodding approvingly and waving Simran's next to last handkerchief. "Got sense. Be good for you, Kazil." "If that's settled, I'm going to go find a snack," said the yellowish-green dragon. Warug looked around, but the other dragon seemed to agree with Roxham.
"Oh, very well," he said grumpily.
"It's your choice after all, Kazil."
"It certainly is. Now, princess, if you'll come this way, I'll get you settled in."
Simran followed Kazil across the cave and down a tunnel. To her relief, the ball of light came with her. She had the uncomfortable feeling that if she had tried to walk behind Kazil in the dark, she would have stepped on her tail, which would not have been a very good beginning. Kazil led her through a long maze of tunnels and finally stopped in another cave. "Here we are," the dragon said. "You can use the small room over on the right. I believe my last princess left most of the furnishings behind when she ran off with the knight."
"Thank you," Simran said.
"When do I start my duties, and what are they, please?"
"You start right away," said Kazil.
"I want dinner at 7. In the meantime, you can begin sorting the treasure."
The dragon nodded toward the dark opening on the left.
"I'm sure some of it needs repairing. There's at least one suit of armor with the leg off, and some of the cheaper magic swords are probably getting rusty. And the rest of it really ought to be rearranged sensibly. I can never find anything when I want it."
"And what about the library you mentioned?" Simran asked.
"We'll see how well you do on the treasure room first," Kazul said. "The rest of your job I'll explain as we go along. You don't object to learning a little magic, do you?"
"Not at all," said Simran.
"Good, it'll make things easier. Go and wash up, and I'll let you into the treasure room so you can get started." The princess nodded and went to the room Kazil had told her to use. As she washed her face and hands, she felt happier than she had in a long time. She was not going to have to marry Therindale, and sorting a dragon's treasure sounded far more interesting than dancing or embroidery. She was even going to learn some magic, and her parents wouldn't worry about her once they found out where she was. And for the first time in her life, Simran was glad she was a princess. She dried her hands and turned to go back to the main cave, wondering how best to persuade Kazil to help her brush up on her Latin. She didn't want the dragon to be disappointed in her skill. "Draco, draconium, dracon," she muttered, and her lips curved into a smile. She had always been rather good at declining nouns. Still smiling, she started forward to begin her new duties. Simran settled in very quickly. She got along well with Kazul and learned her way around the caves with a minimum of mishaps. Actually, the caves were more like an intricate web of tunnels connecting caverns of various shapes and sizes that belonged to individual dragons. It reminded Simran of an underground city with tunnels instead of streets. She had no idea how far the tunnels extended, though she rather suspected that some of them had been magicked so that when you walked down them, you went a lot further than you thought you were going. Kazil's section of caves was fairly large, in addition to the kitchen, which was in a large cave near the exit, so that there wouldn't be a problem with the smoke from the fire. She had a sleeping cavern, three enormous treasure rooms at the far end of an intricate maze of twisty little passages, two even more enormous storage rooms for less valuable items, a library, a large bear cave for eating and visiting with other dragons, and a set of rooms assigned to Simran. All the caves smelled of dragon, a somewhat musty, smoky, cinnamony smell. Simran's first job was to air them out. Her rooms consisted of three small connecting caves just off Kassel's living cavern. They were furnished very comfortably in a mixture of styles and periods, and looked just like the guest rooms in most of the castles Simran had visited, only without windows. They were much too small for a dragon to get inside. When asked, Kazil had said that the doors had made them in return for a favor, and the dragon's tone prevented Simran from inquiring too closely into just what that sort of favor had been. By the end of the first week, Simran was sure enough of her position to give Kazil a list of things that she needed in the kitchen. The previous princess, of whom Simran was beginning to have a very poor opinion, had apparently made do with a very large skillet with three dents and a wobbly handle, a wooden mixing bowl with a crack in it, a badly tarnished copper tea kettle, an assortment of mismatched plates, cups, and silverware, most of them chipped or bent. She seemed pleased by the request, and the following day Simran had everything she had asked for, except for a few of the more exotic pans and dishes. This made the cooking considerably easier and gave Simran more time to spend studying Latin and sorting treasure. The treasure was just as disorganized as Kazil had told her, and putting it in order was a major task. It was sometimes hard to tell whether a ring was enchanted, and Simran knew better than to put it on and see. It might be the sort of useful magic ring that turns you invisible, but it also might be the sort of thing that turns you into a frog. Simran did the best she could and kept a pile in the corner for things she was not sure about. There was a great deal of treasure to be sorted. Most of it was stacked in one of the innermost caves in a large, untidy heap of crowns, rings, jewels, swords, and coins, but Simran kept finding things in other places as well, some of them quite unlikely. There was a small helmet under her bed, along with a great deal of dust, a silver bracelet set with opals on the reading table in the library, and two daggers and a jeweled ink pot behind the kitchen stove. She collected them all, along with the other things that were simply lying around in the halls, and put them back in the storerooms where they belonged, thinking to herself that dragons were clearly not very tidy creatures. The first of the knights arrived at the end of the second week. She was busy cleaning swords. Kazil had been right about their condition. Not only were some of them rusty, but nearly all of them needed sharpening. She was polishing the last flakes of rust from an enormous broadsword when she heard someone calling from the mouth of the cave. Feeling somewhat irritated by the interruption, she rose, carrying the sword, and went to see who it was. As she came nearer to the entrance, she was able to make out the words that whoever it was shouting, "Dragon! Come out and fight! Fight for the Princess of Simran of Linderwell!" "Oh, honestly," Simran muttered, and quickened her step. "Here you," she said as she came out into the sunlight. Then she had to duck as a spear flashed through the air over her head. "Stop that," she cried. "I'm Princess Simran." "You are?" said a doubtful voice. "Are you sure? I mean..." Simran raised her head cautiously and squinted. It was still fairly early in the morning, and the sun was in the back of the person standing outside the cave, so that it was difficult to see anything but the outline of his figure against the brightness. "Of course I'm sure," she said. "What did you expect? Letters of reference? Come around here where I can see who you are, please." The figure moved sideways, and Simran saw that it was a knight in shiny new armor, except for the legs, where the armor was dusty from walking. She wondered briefly why he hadn't ridden, but decided not to ask. The knight's visor was raised, and a few whips of sandy hair showed above his handsome face. He was studying her with an expression of worried puzzlement. "What can I do for you?" she said after several moments had gone by and the knight still said nothing. "Well, if you are the princess, I've come to rescue you from the dragon," the knight said. She put the point of the broadsword on the ground and leaned on it as if it were a walking cane. I thought that might be it," she said. "But I'd rather not be rescued. Thank you just the same." "Not be rescued?" the knight's puzzled look deepened. "But princesses always..." "No, they don't," she said firmly, recognized the beginning of a familiar argument. "And even if I wanted to be rescued, you're going about it all wrong." "What?" said the knight, thoroughly taken back. shouting, "Come out and fight!" the way you did, no self-respecting dragon is going to answer to a challenge like that. It sounds like a child's dare. Dragons are very conscious of their dignity. At least all the ones I've met so far are.
"Oh," said the knight, sounding very crestfallen.
"What should I have said?"
"Stand forth and do battle," is the usual challenge, Simran said with authority, remembering her princess lessons. She'd always been more interested in what the knights and dragons were supposed to say than in memorizing the places where she was supposed to scream. But the wording doesn't have to be exact as long as it's suitably formal. You're new to this, aren't you?
"Rescuing you was going to be my first big quest," the knight said gloomily. "You're sure you don't want to be rescued?"
"Quite sure," she said. "I like living with Kazil."
"You like?"
The knight stared at her for a moment, then his expression cleared and he said, "Oh! Of course, the dragons enchanted you. I should have thought of that before."
"Kazil has not enchanted me, and I do not want to be rescued by anyone," she said, alarmed by the knight's sudden enthusiasm.
"This place suits me very well. I like polishing swords and cooking Cherry's Jubilee and reading Latin scrolls. If you don't believe me, ask anyone in Linderwall. They've been complaining about my unprincess-like behavior for years."
"I did hear something about fencing lessons," the knight said doubtfully. "But knights aren't supposed to pay attention to that kind of thing. We're supposed to be above rumors and gossip."
"The fencing lessons were just the beginning," she assured him. So you see why I'm perfectly happy being a dragon's princess."
Well, yes, said the knight, but he did not look convinced.
"Speaking of dragons, where's yours?"
"Kazil's not my dragon," she said sharply. "I'm her princess. You'll never have any luck dealing with dragons if you don't get those things straight. She's gone to the enchanted forest on the other side of the mountains to borrow a crepe pan from a witch she knows."
"She's what?" said the knight.
"She's gone to borrow a crepe pan," she repeated in a louder voice. "Perhaps you better have your helmet checked when you get back. They're not supposed to interfere with your hearing, but sometimes..."
"Oh, I heard you," the knight said. "But what does a dragon want with a crepe pan?"
"She doesn't want it. I do. I found a recipe in the library that I want to try, and the kitchen just isn't equipped to handle anything but the most ordinary cooking. Kazil will fix that eventually, but for the time being, we have to borrow things like crepe pans and chafflet dishes."
"You really do like it here," the knight said wonderingly.
Simran refrained from replying that this was what she had been trying to tell him all along, and instead said, "How did you know where I was?"
"Things get around," the knight waved a hand in a vague manner. "In fact, I had to hurry to make sure I was the first. Half of the kingdom of Linderwall and a princess's hand in marriage is a reward rich enough to tempt a lot of people who wouldn't normally bother with this sort of thing."
"Father's offered half the kingdom to whoever rescues me?" she said incredulously. "That's more than all my sister's dowries put together."
"It's the usual thing in cases like this," the knight said mildly.
It would be," she said in tones of deep disgust. "Well, at least you can go back and tell them I don't want to be rescued. Maybe that will keep anyone else from coming up here."
"I can't do that," the knight said. "It's just not done," she finished for him.
"I understand perfectly." She gave him a polite farewell, more because she had been well brought up than because she liked being polite, and sent him on his way. Then she went back into the cave and polished the broadsword until it was mirror bright, which relieved her feelings a little. There were two knights the following day, and four more the day after that. On the fourth day, there was only one, but he was exceptionally stubborn, and it took Simran nearly 2 hours to get rid of him. By then, she was thoroughly disgusted, and even considering letting Kazil handle the knights from then on, she could not quite bring herself to do it. The knights would certainly attack her as soon as they saw her, since that's what they were coming for, and sooner or later, someone would get hurt. The princess did not like to think that someone might be hurt trying to rescue her, particularly since she did not want to be rescued. So, with a sigh, she decided she would continue to handle the knights as long as Kazil would let her. Prince Therindel showed up at the end of the third week. He was limping a little, as if his metal boots pinched his toes, and the feathers attached to the top of his helmet sagged badly. He stopped and carefully struck an impressive pose before issuing the usual challenge. She was not in the mood to be impressed. Besides, she could see that his helmet was a different style from his gold armor, and that the armor had gaps in the knees and elbows where it didn't fit together quite right.
"Aren't you a little slow?" she asked irritably.
"There have been 8 knights here before you."
8? The prince said, frowning.
"I thought by now there have been at least 12. Perhaps I better come back later."
She stared at him in surprise.
"Why?"
"Well, it would look better," Therindel explained seriously. There's not much glory in defeating a dragon that hasn't already eaten 10 or 15 people at least. Sir Gorlax of Mirstwood wouldn't even consider going after a dragon whose score is less than 45. I don't think I want to risk waiting that long, but 8 just doesn't seem like enough. You're going to go away and wait until Kazell has defeated 15 knights before you come back and rescue me? She said. She found Therindil's smug confidence very annoying, but she didn't like to say so straight away. Not if you'd rather be rescued now, of course, Therindil said hastily. Though you ought to consider the advantages, I expect it won't be so very long. His voice trailed off, and he looked at her hopefully. I'm afraid it'll be a very long time, she said with satisfaction. You see, Kazell hasn't defeated any knights at all. But I thought you said there'd been 8, he sputtered. I said 8 of them have come by. I didn't say they fought anybody. I sent them away. You sent them away? Therindel repeated, plainly horrified. But that's not done, I know. Simran smiled sweetly. But I've done it, and I tend to go on doing it, so you might as well go home and warn your friends. They'd feel so foolish, you know, if they came all this way into the mountains to rescue me, and then had to turn around and go back home without doing anything. They certainly would, Therindel said indignantly. What do you mean by playing these kinds of tricks? Don't you want to be rescued? No, she said, losing her patience at last. I don't. I'm tired of having my work constantly interrupted, so please go away and don't come back. You can't possibly mean that, Therindel said. Besides, everyone expects me to rescue you. That's your problem, she told him. I'm going to go fix dinner. Goodbye. Before he could say anything else, she turned and ducked back into the cave, hoping the prince wouldn't follow. Right, on to chapter 3 in the next episode, in which Simran meets a witch and has doubts about a wizard.